Good morning. We want to open our service with just a moment of truth. It's a reaction that everyone, when we get caught doing something wrong or something that maybe we shouldn't have done, or is to justify our actions, don't we? It's natural. That's what we do when we get caught. We've all been there. I would have never said that if whatever. I would have never did that if this wasn't the situation. So-and-so, if they said what they said, so I thought, and we figure it out, don't we? We figure out some way to justify what we've done. Do you know what Adam's response was when God was calling him out for participating and eating the fruit? That woman that you gave me. It's interesting that it took several verses for Satan to convince Eve to take of the fruit. It took one verse for Eve to convince Adam. We find ways to justify our actions, don't we? We are responsible for our actions. There are only two ways that we can be justified before God. Never sin, ever. Not a single misstep, nothing. It is the reaction of everyone caught doing something. I'm excited to hear Kevin's justification for that. Everyone claims that, and there's only a couple different ways we can justify anything before God. Is first, we have to never, ever sin. Ever. Well, that's too late to justify ourselves that way, isn't it? That would be being justified by the law, is that I deserve a relationship with God because I've perfectly kept His righteous law. So the only other way to be justified is to receive the gift and grace of God, that He justifies us. Jesus is the justification for us. How can we claim justification according to the law when the Scripture says that all have come short of the glory of God? So an attempt to justify ourselves before God is simply impossible. Charles Spurgeon put it this way. He says, if you attempt to justify yourself, you will simply be a self-deceiver. Do not try it. Romans 8:31 says, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but delivered Him over for us all, how will He not also with Him freely give us all things? Who will bring charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is He who died, but rather was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? We need no other justification except our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, God, I thank You. I thank You, Lord, for being our justifier, our Redeemer, for sending Your only begotten Son, Jesus, to die in our stead, to be our propitiation, to be our substitute, to take our sin penalty, God, and defeat it. And to raise miraculously on the third day, Lord. Thank You so much for the perfect and wonderful plan of salvation You have for us. God, I ask, Lord, that You would meet with us now and and cause our hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth. God, you are an amazing God. It's in your wonderful and powerful name we pray, and amen.
Good morning, sir.
Brother Jim, I tell you what, the minute you launched into that, the first thing that went through my head was, you know, I'd have never done what I did or said what I said if I knew I was going to get caught. Second of all, I think I can justify Kevin. Bear with me. Bear with me.
This should be good.
The Garden of Eden, we talk about the fruit. Now, we know the Bible doesn't actually name the fruit, but everybody associates the fruit with a what? Kevin's smartphone is probably a what? Don't you see how apples get you in trouble?
That's what it was, man.
So it's the apple's fault.
That's what it was.
All right. We're good with you, brother?
Yeah.
Outstanding. Well, listen, it's great to see each and every one of you here this morning. Love to always start off a Sunday morning with a laugh and a smile. But it's always great to see each and every one of you here this morning. Pray that you've had a great week. We're saying goodbye to October today, looking into November, a month of Thanksgiving, and then we go into the greatest month of all and the greatest season through December when we begin to celebrate the season at the birth of Jesus Christ. So let's remember as we go in through the seasons what each and every one of them mean, and let's enjoy each and every moment of them.
Mac, I want to remind everybody real quick that the CMA information and tickets and all that stuff, the tickets are free. But we'll have that information up next week for what we're going to be doing. It'll be very, almost exactly like we did last year. So we're really excited about CMAs this year.
Amen. I tell you what, it's already a lot of the planning going into it. It's going to be a great program. Looking forward to doing that. But I just want to say good morning to you and welcome if you are visiting with us for the very first time, our guest. And just let you know what an honor and privilege it is to have you here with us this morning. And we just thank you for having chose Anchor to be a part of your Sunday morning worship and your fellowship. We're going to ask you to do us one favor. We're not going to signal you out or embarrass you in any way, shape, or form. But we are going to ask you if on your way out this morning, you'll look on the table in the hallway and pick up a blue-colored guest card. Looks just like the one that's on the overhead above. Take a moment, if you would, fill that card out and then leave it sitting right there on that table. We would just love to have a record of your visit with us this morning. Now, if during the service you get intrigued and you would like to know more about Anchor and you would like a visit from somebody, just make a simple note on that card. We'll have one of our members schedule a time that's convenient with you. Come by, answer your questions, and then hopefully we'll welcome you as our newest member at Anchor Church. So again, it's great to have you visiting with us this morning. Congregation, always great to see you here on a Sunday morning. Just pray that we have a great week as we go forward. So we're going to fix to go to our morning social distance wave. And what we do here is we do things a little bit different. We're going to stand up. We're going to stay in place. We're going to turn around. We're going to wave, blow kisses, do whatever we need to do. But let people in and around you know it's good to see them here this morning and that you're glad they're here. And then join us in worship in song.
Thank you. Throughout our church, Father. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Of salt to the fragrance of sin. takes is, Father, for us to accept and realize that we're sinners. And that we were born that way. And we've lived that way. But, Father, there was somebody who you sent because you loved us so much that he gave his life in place of our sins to redeem us and to release us forever from the penalty those sins would have. And Father, all it takes is that we simply believe in Jesus Christ. As I heard this morning on a broadcast, it says, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and shall be saved. It's that simple, Father. You don't have to dress a certain way, talk a certain way, walk a certain way. Father, all you have to do is believe a certain way. And that's that Jesus is God's Son. He is our Lord and Savior. Ask and receive him as the sacrifice for our sins. And we'll forever have that place in heaven as your children. And enjoy the blessings that heaven brings. So, Father, as we go to your word this morning, we just pray that, as you always do, you'll use Brother Jim to open up that word, that you'll speak through him the words that we need to hear. Challenge us, change us, encourage us, direct us. But, Father, use your word to touch each and every one of us in that special way. Let us hear what you have to say for each and every one of us. Then help us always to remember that that which we learn, that which we hear and receive here, does not belong to us. That when we're given that opportunity, we need to take that time and share it with those who simply just might not know what an amazing God you are, and Father, what Jesus could mean to them in their eternity. So Father, you be honored, glorified, lifted up in this hour. We praise, we worship and adore you, and give you all the honor and glory. For it is truly yours and yours alone. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen.
Turn your Bibles to Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 37. The first 14 verses is what we're going to be using for our text today. Kevin and I have debated it in my mind how to... whether I should open the service this way or not open the message this way by way of introduction, but I'm going to go for it. Kevin and I discussed it. I want to say from the outgo that I detest Halloween. I don't like it. I think, I always fall back to this, that it's, we tell our kids to do good. We tell them to be good people. And we teach them, but this one night you can be a devil. You can be a witch. You can be a goblin. You can be someone bad. But anyway, that's my own thing. I'm not being judgmental. And I say all that because I don't want you to be judgmental of me. Because as I was beginning to study for this message, this is what I really feel like God put on, and you'll get it later in the message, is this being Halloween, basically the message could be titled... A skeleton. The skeletons. See, I told you it wasn't going to have the effect, Kevin, that you thought it was going to. See, I can't sell Halloween. I can't. But anyway, I promise you, I purposely did not make this message on dry bones for Halloween. It doesn't have anything to do with it. But in Ezekiel chapter 37, I'm going to go ahead and read our text, and then we'll introduce the message this morning. Beginning with verse 1, it says, "The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and sat me down in the middle of a valley, and it was full of bones. And he caused me to pass among them round about, and behold, there were very many on the surface of the valley, and lo, they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. Again he said to me, Prophesy over these bones, and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. And thus says the Lord God to these bones, Behold, I will cause breath to enter you, that you may come to life. And I will put sinews on you, and flesh grow back on you, cover you with skin, and put your breath in you, that you may come alive, and you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and I prophesied that there was a noise, and behold, a rattling of the bones came together, bone to its bone. And I looked, and behold, sinew were on them, and flesh grew, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, and they come to life. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they came to life and stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army. When we look across our landscape of the world today, we see a world, honestly, that is rotting. It's dying. We see division and conflict everywhere, do we not? Our world has never been as divided as it is today. All the division and the pride that comes with it has not only invaded the world, but it has slid its way into the church. Division. Pride and entitlement have invaded the church to the point that the emphasis and the focus is often to keep up with the one down the street. Whether it's the church or your neighbor, to keep up with it. That's become the focus. The focus of the church has become to inspire you to do better, to inspire you to accomplish things. Not much different than the world. There is no reason why the church, get this, make a note of this. There is no reason why the church cannot worship and minister in a contemporary world without compromising God's word. Amen. I'm going to read that again. I didn't get enough amens. There is no reason why the church cannot worship and minister in a contemporary world without compromising the word. We can do it. We don't have to compromise God's word. We don't have to compromise who we are as believers in Jesus Christ. We don't have to compromise. There is no reason why. There's no reason why each of us as believers cannot live, raise our families, have successful careers, and be active in the community today, in today's society, and not compromise God's word. Because if we do, then we're not living, we're dying. It may not look like it on the outside, but inside, the church and individuals that are the church and making up the church, we're dying. It sort of looks like a valley of dry bones. Where once stood a mighty army, now is just dry bones. A guy was speaking to his prophet, Ezekiel. Israel, because of their sin and their turning away from God, they were dispersed and they were struggling. They weren't accomplishing what God had intended them to accomplish as being His people. Do you know what we're supposed to accomplish? You know what God's people are supposed to be? Our lives are supposed to bring glory and honor to God. That church is what identifies us as being alive. A church that is not glorifying God is dying or dead already. The church is what identifies the church living and worshiping and living in the Word of God is what makes us alive. We were created and designed to bring glory, honor, praise, and thanksgiving to God through Christ. So God now speaks through Ezekiel with a vision. And this vision that he gives Ezekiel is really a vision of hope. And God opens his eyes to see. God in this vision takes Ezekiel to this valley. And I want you to go there for a moment. I want you to think about that as we go into that valley where God takes Ezekiel and he stands and he looks and he sees. And there's a lot of bones laying around. And God causes him, tells him to walk around, look at them, behold them, see them. This valley is littered with bones. You know what I think it might have looked like to Ezekiel and to anybody that would have seen the same thing? It may have looked like that a great battle had taken place there. And that there had been a great army that had been defeated there. That an army that had once stood there had now been defeated and reduced down to just dry bones, was having no effect whatsoever. They were there and they were lifeless. And in verse 11, God describes these bones. He says, "Then he said to me, 'Son of man, these bones are the entire house of Israel. Behold, I say, our bones are dried up. Our hope has perished. We are completely cut off.'" That was the attitude. God says that these bones are my people. Does it look so much differently today? These bones are my people. They have no hope and they were cut off. There's no life in them. Israel had gotten so far away from following the precepts of God that they had struck out on their own, neglecting the principles of God. And there they were. They look helpless. They look like dry bones. What are dry bones good for? Nothing. They exist. That's all they are. This once great army had been reduced to something that was useless, not accomplishing anything. God asked Ezekiel a big question. God says to Ezekiel, he says, "Can these bones live again? Can these bones live?" And I love Ezekiel's answer. God asks, is there any hope for this once mighty army of God to live again? Can these bones be born again and once again be God's intended purpose for his glory? And it was the question to which Ezekiel knew that only God had the answer. And I love how he answers. He says, "O Lord God, you know." Only you know, God. And then God says, "Prophesy over these bones. Talk to them. Tell them. I'm going to tell you what to tell them. I want you to prophesy to these bones. I want you to talk to these bones. I want you to give these bones hope." And church, hope is in the Word of God. In verse 4, he says again, he said to me, "Prophesy over these bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord.'" There's life in the Word of God. What is he going to give these dry bones life again? God said, "Tell them bones," God's people, "to hear the word of God." Church, if there's nothing else that comes out of this message, out of this story, this account, this vision, know this, that God's word changes lives. It's the only thing that brings life. God's word teaches us all the way through. You know this book from the beginning to the end, from the very first verse to the very last verse, is about life in Christ. It's about living. You will never feel more alive than when you're being influenced by God's Word. Living in its precepts, in John it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." When a church gets away from the Word, it begins to die. When a family gets away from the Word of God, it begins to die. When individuals, when we get away from the Word of God, we begin to die. When our families are founding on something different than the Word of God, they begin to die. One of the most discouraging things I see going on is that we come to church on Sunday and we get an inspired message, and we go home and live according to the world. We raise our kids according to the world's principles. What's good and what fits into our world. When our lives begin to seek approval of man and to fit in with the world instead of seeking the Word of God, and although we look good to the world, we are really a valley of dry bones. But there's hope. There is hope in the Word of God. God says, tell the bones, that's His people, that His Word will breathe life back in them. Do you remember back in the beginning, it says that God formed man out of the dust of the earth, but he was just there. And then the Bible tells us that God breathed in his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. In Timothy, it says that all Scripture is inspired by God. It is breathed by God, and it's life-giving. Just as much as each physical breath that we have, that we take in, comes from God, we are dead spiritually without God's breathed Word giving life. There was a young man came to me many, many years ago. I was a youth pastor at the time. And Eddie came to me and he said, I've been wanting to date this girl. We've been kind of seeing each other. And he said, but I got a problem. Yeah, I really like her a lot. He said, but she's not a Christian. I don't know what to do. She's a nice girl, but I don't know. I just feel like I don't know. And I said, well, Eddie, I said, why don't you invite her to church? Why don't you invite her to come along? You don't have to take the relationship any further than that. Just invite her to church. This young lady came to class a few times and came to church a few times. And Larissa accepted Christ as her personal Savior. Win, right? So good. But here's the rest of the story. Larissa came up to me just a few weeks after that, and she said, Jim, do you know what the Bible said over here? She said, Jim, you know what I read in the Bible and what it says here? And she had just fallen in love with the Word of God. I've never seen a young lady grow so much in her faith. I told Eddie, he passed him up a long time ago. This young lady, I've used her for an example for many, many years because she grew so fast. She was a seasoned saint of God within just a few months because she got in touch and in love with God's Word. I'm telling you, God's Word is what gives us life as believers. It's how we get to know God. In Ezekiel 37:14, he says, I will put my Spirit within you and you will come to life. And I will place you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken and done it, declares the Lord. Without the Spirit of God in us, we are just dry bones. Without the Spirit of God, we have no life. He says he'll put sinews, and that's just the tendons and the cartilage and things that connects bones to muscle and muscles to other muscles. It gives us strength in the body. This great army of God is connected by God. And every part of it works together and gives us strength. He will cover it with flesh, skin. This is the protection for the body. Now, there's this thing. I've always been fascinated about skin. That sounds weird, doesn't it? But I've been fascinated by it. Skin is an amazing organ in our body. You know that? It's really amazing. Do you know that you can go outside in the pouring rain and you know it is a lie to come back in and say I'm soaked to the bone? No, you're not. You're just soaked to the skin. Because the skin is waterproof. We are made waterproof. It's not by accident that when God is putting these bodies together here in this vision, That he says the bones are connected to the bones, and then the flesh, the muscles are put together with the cartilage. And then it's not a mistake that he says, then they are covered with skin. He protects that. Do you know water can come out of our skin but not go in? So what is living inside of us can come out for the whole world to see, but nothing can come in and take it away or change it. That is the protection we get from God's Word. We can be a mess on the outside, but nothing has changed on the inside. So Ezekiel did as he was commanded, and he began to preach to the bones and the words of God, and something happened. I love the way Ezekiel described what he saw, and in this case, what he heard. He said he started to hear a rattling. He heard the bones starting to rattle, starting to make some noise, starting to do something. The bones began to rattle. The parts of the body began coming together. Imagine that. The parts of the body coming together. Whether it's the individuals or as a church, the parts of the body, all of us, begin to come together. That'll make some noise. All the vital organs begin to grow, and the flesh and then the skin covered them, but there was still no life. So God said, call for the breath. Call for the breath of God. The breath is the Spirit of God, and he called for it, and God sent it. And then he says that those that were once dead, dry bones. Think about that for a moment. These weren't just bones. These were dry bones. It says that they stood up. It doesn't just say that they came alive. It says that the bones stood up. Church, we need to take a stand. When we're alive in Christ, when our hearts are overwhelmed with the Spirit of God and we're strong in God's Word, we will stand up. We look around at our world and we talk about how we're getting beat down and how the world is persecuting Christians and how they're pounding down on Christians and we can't cower down. He says, stand. Greater is he that is in you than he is in the world. We can take a stand for what is right. We can take a stand for the cause of Christ. If our church here at Anchor is going to stand out in the community, then we need to take a stand for Christ. If our family is going to stand out in the neighborhood and in the community that we live in, then we take a stand for Christ. Whether we're at work or play or whatever we're doing, we do all for the glory of God. We take a stand for Christ. That's what looks different. If we're doing anything else but focusing and learning and grasping and living through the Word of God, if we're doing anything else, how different are we than any other group that gathers and fellowships? Not only were they now alive, but the Scripture says they were a great army. As God gives us life through His Word, we are His great army. Church, I know the message hasn't been especially long this morning, but I want to close. Church, that is what the Word of God does. It quickens us. It gives us life. God speaks through it. It reveals who we are. It reveals our hope. Our hope to live in Him. Christ is the Word, and we are in Him. It takes these dead, dry bones and gives them life. I love it how he uses this vision to show Israel coming together all the people, bone upon bone. You know, God's Word teaches us that we may be a hand or a foot or an eye or, you know, as part of the body. We're part of the body. And the symbolism here is that body comes together. You know, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Amen? If you look and see how a shoulder works, it's incredible. How a knee works. How incredible that is. How it's put together. How every piece of cartilage, everything is put together in the right place. And of course, I don't know whether it's famous or infamous, that I don't have to plug my heart up at night. It just keeps pumping. We're fearfully and wonderfully made. Every part of the body doing their function. And he takes these bones and he begins to piece them together. And he puts flesh on them. He gives them strength. What a picture of what he's doing to Israel and bringing his people together. And he does the same for us. And how he does it is the same. Is the Word of God. It takes these dead, dry bones and gives them life. He gives us strength. He gives us protection. God wants to raise up a great army, and he will do it with his power and with his word. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for your word. God, I ask now that you would take my broken words, God, and you would use them, Lord, to further your kingdom. God, I pray that you would just take your message. God, we need you. We need your word. We need to be strengthened. God, we need to take a stand. God, we need you to do all of that. God, surround us with your love, your protection. Give us the strength to stand for you, to do your way and your will always. God, we love you so much. We ask now, Lord, if there be anyone here this morning, God, that doesn't know you, I pray that you would take your word now and penetrate their heart, God, and call them to yourself. God, help us all to be encouraged to move forward for you, to take a stand wherever we are and stand on your word. God, we thank you and we praise you. We give you all praise and glory. It's in your wonderful name we pray, and amen.
If you have any decision to make today, maybe you'd like to give your heart to Christ once and for all. Maybe you'd like to be funded for a bigger church. Whatever your need may be today, Jim will be up front for you. So feel free to come forward and speak to Jim while we sing this song. Would you stand with us? Yeah.
before we dismiss this service, I did want to make one quick announcement. The Feed the Hunger thing, the ministry, a wonderful, powerful ministry, and thank you so much for being a part of that and giving all that you have to this point. We're going to need to postpone that into the spring. And so just want to encourage you, don't stop praying, don't stop giving. And that is a wonderful ministry. We're going to continue. Just some factors that cause the dates need to be changed and moved out to the spring. So keep that in your prayers as God uses us in that that amazing ministry. So be prayerful about that. We're going to have our Lord's Supper service immediately following this service. We'll pray together, and then we'll begin that service. Let's pray together.